Good morning.
Good morning.
If any of you have been parents, maybe you have found yourself in this situation. Your child comes to you very upset because they haven't been treated well when they've tried to do what's right, and they say something like, "It's just not fair." And what have you found yourself saying? Life's not fair. Well, it never gets easier to get over that sense of injustice when we're just not treated fairly, when we're trying to do something right. And that's what I want to look at today. What do we do? What do we do as followers of Jesus Christ when people just are not fair to us? Let's look at your prayer request. On the back of your bulletins, we have some additions for this week. Conrad and Mabel Barbie, health concerns. Please remember Connie Brooks. She's still in the hospital. Pray for her with all your heart. And also Dickie, as he cares for her, that he would have wisdom and strength. Pray for the family of Michael King. Pray for Glenn Morse, who's recovering from shoulder surgery due to a fall. And then also Jay Garner is awaiting heart surgery. Pray for him. Let's go to the Lord in prayer now. Father, we come to worship you, and we confess to you that sometimes we feel stomped on. Sometimes we feel misunderstood. Life just doesn't seem fair. I pray that you would help us today to remember the heaven that you have made for us. I pray that we would remember Jesus and how he was treated and how he is rewarded, and we are rewarded in him. I pray that you would turn our hearts to praise today. And Lord, all these concerns that are on our hearts, questions we have on our minds, I pray that we'll bring them to you and that we'll find answers with Jesus. All God's people said, amen. Amen. Let's stand as we sing, "There's a Land That's Fairer Than Day." Psalm 37 is a great prayer to mark out in your Bible. I'll call it an after news prayer. So after you've looked at Fox or MSNBC or Facebook or Apple News or any one of the other many highly balanced, impartial, without agenda news sources that you may choose from, after you hear what's going on in the world, if you're like me, it's not always comforting. It's very disturbing. It riles me up. Well, let's pray Psalm 37, verses 3 through 11 together. Trust in the Lord and do good. Then you will live safely in the land and prosper. Take delight in the Lord, and He will give you your heart's desires.
Commit everything you do to the Lord. Trust Him, and He will help you.
He will make your innocence radiate like the dawn, and the justice of your cause will shine like the noonday sun.
Be still in the presence of the Lord, and wait patiently for Him to act.
Don't worry about evil people who prosper or fret about their wicked schemes. Stop being angry. Turn from your rage.
Do not lose your temper. It only leads to harm. The wicked will be destroyed, but those who trust in the Lord will possess the land.
Soon, the wicked will disappear. Though you look for them, they will be gone. The lowly will possess the land and will live in peace and prosperity.
Amen.
Amen, Lord, help us. Let's stand again as we sing about heaven on Jordan's stormy banks.
Let us pray. Dear Heavenly Father, we thank you for another beautiful Lord's Day and for this time that we can come into your house and study your word and to sing your praises. And Lord, we thank you for all the many blessings that you continue to bestow upon this church each and every day and for all the many blessings that you continue to bestow upon us. And Lord, we thank you for this time of the service where we have an opportunity to give back a small portion of all that you have allowed us to have. And Lord, we ask that you bless the gift and the giver, and we ask that you take these tithes and offerings, multiply them, and use them for the betterment of thy kingdom. These things we ask. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Paper. You think it's paper? Y'all come on and have a seat. Let's see what kind of paper this is. You guys are smart. You got the pencil part right. Now what is this right here?
Paper. Oh, we learned that at school.
You did learn that at school?
Me too.
This is a second grade math test. Bet you can. I want to tell you about a little boy named Skip. Skip was in second grade, and it came time for the math class, and the teacher passed out these papers, and everyone had their pencils. And Skip had a friend named Bradley who sat right next to him. And the teacher said she'd be right back, and she had to go take care of something. And she went over to the closet and messed with it, and Bradley was like, "Skip, Skip." And you know what Bradley was doing to Skip? Bradley said, "What was Bradley asking Skip to do?"
To see his paper.
Yeah, is that right?
Yes.
Well, it's not right, because this was a test, and so everyone was supposed to do their own work. If you copy someone else's work when you're not supposed to, you know what that's called when you copy something?
Yes.
Cheating, that's right. And Skip knew that wasn't right, and so you know what Skip did? Yeah, he didn't do what Bradley asked him to. He just kept doing his own test. You know what happened when the teacher turned around? Bradley got so mad at Skip, because Skip wouldn't show him his test, that he raised his hand and went up and told the teacher that Skip was trying to cheat off of his paper.
No, he wasn't.
No, he wasn't.
He was trying to be fair.
Yes, exactly. That was a lie. How do you think Skip felt when Bradley did that to him?
Mad.
Yeah, he's mad. And he got so upset, and you know what? He and Skip got in trouble because the teacher couldn't tell which one of them was lying. And so Skip went home, and he was so mad, and he told his mom, "Mom, I don't understand. You taught me to do what's right, and I know Jesus wouldn't want us to cheat. How come I got in trouble?" And you know what his mommy said? She said, "Skip, I believe you, but you know, when Jesus did the right thing, did they always treat him well? Were people ever mean to Jesus?"
"No."
"Well, some people weren't. But you know, some people were so mean to Jesus, they even put him on a cross. And he died." So sometimes when we do the right thing, some people will not like that. And they may be mean. But does that mean we stop doing what's right? No. Because we want to keep on following Jesus. Okay, let's pray now. Let's close our eyes and bow our heads. Lord, when people sometimes are mean to us or lie to us or about us, Lord, help us to keep on following Jesus. Help us, protect us, and help us to keep on doing the right thing. Amen. Thank you. Matthew chapter 5. Matthew chapter 5. I invite you to turn there in your Bibles. So we're wrapping up a stretch of what Jesus is saying. So that's what a New Testament professor named James Blevins called much of what Jesus said, because he would say things that just put conventional wisdom on its head and people would go, "What, Jesus?" So what Jesus is he saying here? We started in Matthew chapter 5, verse 3. "Blessed are the poor in spirit, for theirs is the kingdom of heaven." The poor are blessed, happy. What, Jesus? "Blessed are those who mourn, for they shall be comforted." You know, people who are dealing with grief and mourning are blessed. What, Jesus? "Blessed are those who are meek, for they shall inherit the earth." Really, Jesus? Those who treat others with mildness and consideration, those are the people that get ahead in this world. What, Jesus? "Blessed are those who hunger and thirst for righteousness, for they shall be satisfied." Verse 7, "Blessed are the merciful, for they shall receive mercy." "Blessed are the pure in heart, for they shall see God." "Blessed are the peacemakers, for they shall be called the sons of God." Last time, we looked at just verse 9, peacemakers, and an old soldier texted me that week, and he said, "I've been trying to kill people with kindness, and it's taking a lot longer than I expected." What, Jesus? Then we get to verse 10, the biggest "what, Jesus" of them all. "Blessed are those who are persecuted for righteousness' sake." So when you're doing what's right and people treat you badly for it, you're blessed. "For theirs is the kingdom of heaven." "Blessed are you when others revile you and persecute you and utter all kinds of evil against you falsely on my account. Rejoice and be glad, for your reward is great in heaven. For so they persecuted the prophets who were before you." Father God, your Son showed us your heart. He spoke these words from your mind. This is your word to us today. Help us to understand what you are saying. Help us to open our minds and our hearts. Help me to open my mind and my heart to your word. Speak. Do what you want in our lives today. In Christ we pray. Amen. Any of you over the age of 10 might have noticed that pressure is building against Christians these days. Can I get a witness? I mean, it seems to be just picking up speed. I remember growing up, preachers and other Christians saying things like, one day in this country, if we keep on going this way, if we keep on calling the wrong right and the right wrong, if we do nothing, one day, even though it's unthankful to you, Christians could be persecuted in this country. And we all were kind of like, yeah, I guess I hear what you're saying. Maybe a long time from now, maybe my great-grandkids might have. Hey, we're at the gates, folks. Some of you are all tied up in the culture wars. Hey, the day that the battle was won or lost as far as anything remotely Christian running this culture, that ship has sailed. We're in the after effects of that battle being decided, and we have to decide, what do we do when misunderstanding, mistreatment, hostility, lies come at us because we do what's right? In a sense, Jesus' words to us are more relevant now than they have been for hundreds of years, for Western Christians, at least. So what do we do now when living for Jesus doesn't seem fair? When we're just not getting a fair shake and things don't seem to be reasonable anymore? Now, I have to disagree with some who say that we used to live in a golden age somehow, and where Christ was exalted. I don't think Christians, even when we were in control, if you want to call it that in this country, were ever perfect. And our list of sins are long. List of grievances against us are long. And yet, what can we do when the foundations of right and wrong are shaken? Jesus says, blessed are those who persecuted for righteousness' sake, for theirs is the kingdom of heaven. What does this mean to me? I want to ask folks in the eagle's nest up there to raise the screen behind me. I find it ironic that that's hidden behind a screen most Sundays. It doesn't escape me. What is that behind me? The universally accepted symbol of Christians everywhere. Many of you may be wearing one around your neck right now. May have one hanging at your house. You may have a decal or something on your car that has a cross on it. This is a symbol of following Jesus. I want to invite you to stop a minute and think about what this symbol represents. What happened there? Well, what happened there is the Son of the Living God came to this planet Earth and walked among us, grew up, lived, learned his alphabet, learned to follow his Father in heaven, became a human being with the name Yeshua, Jesus. Grew up in a place called Nazareth, a small town, smaller than Warsaw, more like Irvington. And in the fullness of time, he began to speak and stand up for what was right, to stand up and share God's heart with the generation that was hungry, starving to have something other than the empty religion that they saw around them and the brute force of an empire, of a government that didn't represent them. Jesus came sharing the love and the holiness of Father God, the creator that made all of us. And many people embraced him. Many people fell down before him in worship and wanted to follow him, wanted to be as close as possible to him. Other people were irritated, jealous. Many people who were the powers that be hated his guts. Because he was mean to them? Because he spoke the truth and he just wouldn't go away. He wouldn't get in line and follow the way of the status quo. And in the fullness of time, people's hatred towards him became so intense that there you have him. He was put to death by torture on a cross after a sham trial because he did what was right. And more than that, he would not fight fire with fire when people came out against him. He stopped his own disciples from killing other people who would arrest him. And so he died on the cross for you, for me, because he was persecuted in a world that would not accept him. Now, this is the Jesus that we follow. Amen? Can we agree on that? That's him. So, the first thing that Jesus, I think, would want to communicate to us here is, I beg your pardon, I never promised you a rose garden. Now you're going to be hearing that song all day if you're past a certain age. If you're a little younger, every rose has its thorns. I beg your pardon, I never promised you a rose garden. Why should you and I be surprised when we're sometimes treated like our Lord? Now that's a good question for Americans to ask ourselves. We get all stirred up in the revolutionary spirit. I've got nothing against the revolution, okay? Or Charles and Andrew would have a serious talk with me afterwards. But when it comes to following Jesus Christ as a servant greater than his master, if we want Jesus' crown, are we going to skip his cross? I bet if we talk to your great-grandparents living back in the golden age, so to speak, and if you could go back there and actually try to follow Jesus Christ and do what he said in that generation, you'd be persecuted then too. There was plenty of hypocrisy to go around in my great-grandparents' generation. Amen? Anyone who really follows what Jesus says is begging for some of the cross. Because this world is a mixed bag. There are people who are hungry for the love of God, and there are people who want to keep God as far away as possible. John chapter 15, a very important passage. Turn with me, if you will, just a few pages over to John chapter 15, verse 18. Okay, Christians, if you want to follow Jesus, if you want to go to heaven, if you want to have your life reborn and transformed, if you want to do what Jesus says and encounter all the joy and wonder of what it means to be restored to your Father in heaven, hear our Master, hear our older brother, hear our friend, hear our Savior as he speaks to us in chapter 15, verse 18 of John. If the world hates you, know that it has hated me before it hated you. If you were of the world would love you as its own. But because you were not of the world, but I chose you out of the world, therefore the world hates you. Verse 20. Remember, Jesus says, remember the word that I said to you. A servant is not greater than his master. If they persecuted me, they will also persecute you. If they kept my word, they will also keep yours. And at the end of your New Testaments, in 1 Peter chapter 4, flip on over to there. 1 Peter chapter 4, verse 12. Beloved, do not be surprised at the fiery trial if it comes upon you. Is that what it says? When it comes upon you to test you, as though something strange were happening to you. But rejoice insofar as you share Christ's sufferings, that you may rejoice and be glad when his glory is revealed. I have a good friend who was a missionary. He taught high school, actually, for many years at a Christian school in Nazareth, not Pennsylvania, but Israel. Nazareth, you know, where Jesus grew up. In the early 20th century, Nazareth was majority Christian. They weren't Western Christians, they were Arab Christians there. And for many, many centuries, Christians had a strong foothold there in Nazareth. And as time has gone on, now I think Christians are down to 30% of the Nazareth community, because Christians there have been under incredible pressure over the years. They're getting persecution several different directions at the same time. Their fellow Arabs don't trust them, resent them, because they're not Muslim. They suspect that they might sympathize with their enemies. So they're persecuted by their fellow Arabs, their fellow countrymen. Jews persecute them. Why? Because they're Arabs. And you know full well how wonderful the relationship is between many Jews and Arabs in Israel. And Western Christians, at least, have not really sympathized and come to their defense. Why? Because they're Arabs. And we're on Israel's side. So here you have this group of Christians being persecuted by other Muslims, by Jews, and ignored by Western Christians. And you know what it's done? That friend of mine said that he had talked to his friends there in Nazareth many times, and they would always remember something. They would say, "We follow Jesus of Nazareth." They identified very closely with Jesus, and they remembered when their Lord said what he said, and when others said of him, "Can anything good come from Nazareth?" You know, when they put him on the cross, you know, they actually put Jesus of Nazareth on the cross. You know, I mean, because that was an insult. That was a put down, right? They knew a servant was not greater than his master. So the first thing that maybe we should just clear up here, okay, I've spent a lot of time on this, probably too much time, is just this: Christians, Americans, Virginians, Northern Neckers, stop being outraged and surprised that the world misunderstands you and can't stand you. Because Jesus says, "I beg your pardon, I never promised you a rose garden." If you do what's right, if you follow Jesus truly, many people will love you for it. And you'll have many blessings, and you'll be blessed. but you'll also be misunderstood and hated. A second, check your contribution to persecution. Check your contribution to persecution. Now, if I had to sum that up in an easier to understand sentence, it would be, am I acting like Jesus or a jerk? Am I acting like Jesus or a jerk? In other words, if I want to know what to do when I'm being unfairly treated because I believe a marriage is between a man and a woman, or if I'm unfairly treated because I believe that this is right and this is wrong, or that God's word is the final authority, or that people are actually either going to spend an eternity reunited with their Father in heaven or an eternity separated from Him in hell, and other things that the world doesn't want to hear, if I want to know why I am being persecuted and how I should do, I should first of all make sure of why I'm being persecuted. Why people are opposing me. Check my contribution to this persecution. Have you ever had to apologize for another Christian to an unbeliever? I have many times. I'm sure maybe some people have done it for me. You know what I'm talking about. That Christian who acts like a jerk and then everyone's upset with them, they can't stand them, and he said, well, this is what happens when you say what's right. I'm just speaking the truth. And you're like, no, that's not why people don't like you. It's because you're arrogant. It's because you're a bull in the china shop. It's because you're acting like a jerk. It has nothing to do with Jesus. It has everything to do with how you're acting. Well, check that. If people are treating us in this country with disdain, if we're lied about, if we're misunderstood, could some of it be due to Christians not acting like Jesus? Think about it. What are Christians known for in this land of ours? Unity, love, joy, understanding. If you want a helping hand, go to a Christian. If you want someone to pray for you and have compassion on you, go to a Christian. Is that what we're known for? We need to make sure, as we're getting whipped up into a self-indignant frenzy, that we're being persecuted for the right reasons. Look at what Jesus says here back in Matthew 5. Blessed are those who are persecuted for righteousness' sake. It's not talking about self-righteousness. It's talking about doing what's right. If you're being persecuted, make sure that you're doing what's right. Blessed are you, in verse 11, when others insult you, persecute you, and utter all kinds of evil against you falsely. Falsely on my account. So, Christian, if you go to work, or you're trying to follow God's call in your life, and people come down on you like a ton of bricks because you're humbly and lovingly trying to do what's right, and you will not admit that what is wrong is wrong, be happy. Know that Jesus is with you, and know that you are being persecuted because you are His. But this does not apply to you. This does not apply to me. If I go up to my friend who doesn't understand who Jesus is, and I take this Bible and hit them over the head with it and treat them wrongly, or if they attack me and I turn right around and attack them harder, that's not persecution. That's just fighting like the world fights. Check your contribution to persecution. Leading up to persecution and responding to it. Oh, it is so hard. It is so difficult to respond like Jesus when we're treated like Jesus. I've alluded to you before some situations I've had several times in my life, key points in my life. You are right there with me. I have been in situations where I humbly and with much prayer and really long suffering, because I knew what was coming. I stood up for what was right, and then it hit me like a ton of bricks, and someone unfairly hated me or opposed me. I've had people who wouldn't shake my hand. I've had people who tried to have me fired. The list goes on and on. I've had people hate my guts. And I had to do some serious soul searching. Why am I being treated this way? Is there something in their attacks, Lord? Please search my heart. But what was really difficult is when right there in the thick of it, when they come at me and I wanted so badly to come back at them. Amen? I remember on my painting crew, there was a man, I told you about him before, who hated my guts. And I still to this day have no idea why. I was just trying to do what was right. And just trying to follow Jesus. And I maybe he just didn't like the color of my eyes. Or maybe I think it was because I was going into ministry. And he had some baggage there. And he just didn't like me. Just didn't like me. And he made my life miserable. Every day I'd go into work and I would try to be prayed up, knowing that he was going to make snide remarks, knowing he was going to be talking about me, knowing he was going to be giving false reports about me to the boss. I knew all that. And I'd be all prayed up like, Jesus, I am ready to face this just with you and like you. And then when he looked at me in the eye and said some of the things he did, oh, it was everything within my power. Just to put an end to the situation. You know what I mean? Give him something to think about. It's hard. It's very difficult. And yet, if we can continue to stand in the truth of Jesus, and that's difficult in this world, stand in the truth of Jesus, in the spirit of Jesus, this world has no answer or defense to that. The power of the living God cannot be stopped by a human being who is standing on the truth of Jesus, in the spirit of Jesus. Even persecution can do nothing but add to the power of God in that person's witness. I believe with all my heart that one of the biggest reasons why Christianity has kind of come to a shuddering halt in this country is because Christians, when we have come under pressure and under persecution, then turn and try to fight the battle like the world, and so give up the Christ who we've been called to follow. Look at history. 12 dropouts. People who weren't even that good at fishing or tax collecting. People who had even so weak that they couldn't stick by Jesus under pressure when the going got tough. And yet people, when they saw the risen Lord, followed him and were willing to lay their lives down to him. And that 12, turned to 120 disciples, and the world began to oppose them. And over the centuries, the Roman Empire and the different governments tried to stamp out Christianity and torture us and kill us and throw us to the lions. And as Christians continue to stand for the truth of Jesus in the spirit of Jesus, they could not be stopped because God can't be stopped. Just as when Satan thought that he had finally crushed the love of God on the cross, and on Easter morning when my Lord rose from the dead, he found out that he could not stop the Holy Spirit of God. This world cannot stop the Spirit of God working in you when you're following Jesus under persecution and living like him in it. And so replace your agitation with celebration. Replace your agitation with celebration. Over and over again, I've kind of brought this out to you. And it's not just something at Cobham Park, I believe. It's in all the churches that I've encountered in this community. We are agitated. We're riled up. Satan's really rattled our cage. We don't even know where to begin to deal with this messed up world. You know, we turn to sexuality and think, well, maybe we can do something there. And then we turn to abortion. Well, maybe we can lift up the sanctity of life there. And then, well, no, maybe we can shift over here. And we just don't know where to start because it's just like the tsunami of the world sweeping over us and crushing all that we used to think was normal and true and self-evident. And so we become very agitated because we don't know what to do. When really, if we hear what Jesus has to say to us, we'd realize there's nothing strange going on here. And what we're required to do is not a big mystery. It's simply to follow Jesus, believe in his truth, and act like him. That's all there is to it. Give your life over to him. The results are the Lord's. The results aren't bound by our expectations or our abilities. And so our agitation and our frustration and our incredible anger and our sense of hopelessness and helplessness, we could set that aside and look at the Jesus that the cross couldn't stop and celebrate what is coming. Blessed are you when others revile you and persecute you and utter all kinds of evil against you falsely on my account. Rejoice, Jesus says, not Keith. Jesus says, be happy. Take joy and be glad. Why? Because you're finally going to win that election. No, that's not what he says. He says, for your reward is great in heaven. And there will be a new heavens and a new earth. For so they persecuted the prophets who were before you. Christians, stand up and do all you can for the truth. Don't be silent. Don't sit on your hands. If you can follow Jesus as an accountant, follow him there. If you could follow Jesus as you're hammering nails, follow him there. If you could follow Jesus sitting in your chair at home, pray with all your heart there. If you could run for office and be a Christian politician. If you can be a pastor following Jesus, follow him there. If you can work at the grocery store or as a mechanic or as a housewife, follow him there. But when you're persecuted and when you're opposed, rejoice, because you know you're the Lord's, and nothing can take away the Lord from you and what is waiting for you. When you trust him, when you value what he values, I realize that much of my frustration and agitation is because my heart is all entangled and wrapped up with the things of this world rather than the things of Jesus that are forever. And my hope has been forgotten. That's why I'm so agitated, because for a second I've looked at the news, or I've looked at this situation right in front of me, and I've forgotten what's coming behind it. He is coming, and great is your reward. Celebrate the fact that if you share some of the cross, you share all his glory. All of it. Because the servant is not greater than his master. If they treat you a little bit like Jesus, in a negative sense, you just take that as a down payment for Easter morning that is coming. For the new heavens and the new earth that is coming for you. Don't let this world steal your joy. There's nothing that the world can say or do or answer to the Christian who is unfairly treated, and yet they are still full of the joy of Jesus Christ. People will go, what? Maybe this Jesus stuff is real. Yes, because it is. Some of you have no sense of frustration with the world. This message isn't really for you. For those of you like me who've been a little shaken up lately, hear the word of Jesus. Listen to what he says. Let's stand as we sing. God, we need your help. You know what it's like to be in a world that is confused and hungry, a world that is hurting and hostile. And Lord, often we find ourselves being targets of the frustration and the pain that others are experiencing. Father God, help us. We're not perfect. You know that. You know that we're not perfect witnesses to you. We lose our tempers. We get confused. We don't know what to say or do. Lord, help us in the Spirit to simply be faithful as we entrust ourselves to you. And Lord, I believe there are some here this morning who are experiencing pain in their own families, with their closest friends, in work every day. The suffering that comes from sharing your truth and your Spirit. Lord, give blessing and joy even in that trial. Lord, help us to draw close to your heart, knowing that you are there and have been there, and that there is a wonderful life coming, a reward for all of us in you. In Christ's name, help us. Amen.